The church won't say good morning and welcome. We're glad you're here, and if you're visiting with us, we'd like to say a special welcome to you. And just ready to worship this morning and be in prayer for our pastors. He's going to bring the word after a while and all the singing. So if you're out in the parking lot with us, we'd like to say a special welcome to you as well. Anybody watching this morning. So if you have your Bibles with you, love for you to turn with me in Psalm. And it's 145, and Pastor Zad's going to be picking up in Genesis chapter 8 there towards the end, and chapter 9 there, and something about that we see when Noah comes off the boat, he praises the Lord. And we're here this morning to praise and to worship, lift high the name of God and exalt Christ, and we're going to read this in 145, Psalm 145. It's great as the Lord. So we'll pick up our reading here, 145, verse 1. It says, I will extol you, my God and King, and bless your name forever and ever. Every day I will bless you and praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised.
Amen.
And his greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall commend your works to another and shall declare your mighty acts on the glorious splendor of your majesty, and on your wondrous works I will meditate. They shall speak the might of your awesome deeds, and I will declare your greatness. They shall pour forth the frame of your abundant goodness, and shall sing aloud your righteousness. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. The Lord is good to all, and his mercy is over all that he has made. All your works shall give thanks to you, O Lord, and all your saints shall bless you. They shall speak of the glory of your kingdom and tell of your power, to make known the children of man your mighty deeds and the glorious splendor of your kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures throughout all generations.
Amen.
The Lord is faithful in all his words and kind in all his works. The Lord upholds all who are falling and raises up all who are bowed down. The eyes of all look to you, and you will give them food in due season. You open your hand, you satisfy the desire of every living thing. The Lord is righteous in all his ways.
Amen.
And kind in all his works. The Lord is near to all who call on him, to all who call on him in truth. He fulfills the desire of those who fear him. He also hears their cry and saves them. The Lord preserves all who love him, but all the wicked he will destroy. My mouth will speak the praise of the Lord, and let all flesh bless his holy name forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen. Church, if you will, please stand. And men, if y'all will come forward. We're going to start by taking our offering, praise and worship that way through our tithe. I need a couple more here, fellas. One more. Thanks, guys. Robert, would you open us this morning, brother?
Father God, we come to you today, Lord. We're grateful and thankful for this another day in which you've given us to live and this wonderful opportunity we have to come here to Bethlehem, dear Lord, and meet with our church family and worship you, dear Lord, and read from your word and study it together corporately as a group and as a family, dear Lord. I just pray for Brother Zad this morning as he stands for your word, that we would have open hearts and minds to receive it, that we would take it from this place to a lost and dying world. Bless this offering and use it for thy service. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
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 Start out with where can I go?
Thank you.
just a closer walk.
Thank you.
I would understand the fellowship one of another, and we'll do our best to help.
I Come behold the wondrous victory, Christ the Lord upon the tree. In the stead of ruined sinners, hangs a Lamb in victory. See the price of our redemption, see the Father's plan unfold, bringing many sons to glory, grace and treasure, love unfold. Come behold the wondrous mystery, slain by death, the God of life. But no grave could ever restrain him. Praise the Lord, he is alive. What a foretaste of deliverance. Now unwavering our hope, Christ in
come behold the wondrous mystery. Amen. I'm sitting there thinking, I wanted to sing that song. If I was going to sing it, that's how I would have done it right there. And don't it just bless your heart to know that I pick up a guitar or try to get on a piano and I can't do anything, and then these guys and many that of y'all can just pick up an instrument and just rock on with it and know how to play it. God gifts the body with different gifts, doesn't he? Amen. If you have your Bibles, I invite you to turn with me to Genesis chapter 3. Genesis chapter 9, excuse me. The promise in Genesis 3:15 is on my mind and heart this morning. Genesis 9. We're going to be picking up, you'll probably have it in your Bible, pick up in verse 20. To go through. You'll probably have a heading in your scripture that says God's covenant with Noah, and we'll roll down to verse 17 by God's grace this morning as we walk through the message. God is loving and faithful forever. There are certain things in life that is sure, and this is sure. God is a loving God. He abounds with steadfast love and faithfulness, and his faithfulness endures forever. And the church holds on to that. This is what steadies us. This is who God has revealed himself to be to us, that he is a God who is loving and faithful forever. Amen. Thankful to our brother Tyler last week who walked through 8 for us and touched then on 20 to 22. And I just want to segue into that as we look at God's covenant faithfulness. We get in now and we're gonna spend a little time just to lay some foundation for us in understanding covenant. Our God is a God of covenant. The God of Israel, the God of the Gentiles now, the God of the nations, is a God who is abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. This is who he will reveal himself to be. We have seen that the flood thus far is what? It has been a divine judgment from God in response to the evilness of the human heart. Humanity, at their core, at their heart, is wicked. Everyone. That's irrespective of American, Chinese, whoever. You plug it in. All of humanity is stamped and defined by sin. And the result in Noah's day was widespread corruption and violence. So much so that it sickened God. It broke his heart. And he starts over with Noah. Noah, who we know found grace in the eyes of the Lord. If we ever know the Lord, if we ever walk with the Lord, it is only by his grace. It's only by his goodness. And so this morning we see God's covenant with Noah that he promised in chapter 6 verse 18, come now and is established. He gives
the instructions or the stipulations between himself and Noah and his family and with creation and what they are to do. And so this is some foundational things that we learn about God and his covenant. It's in chapter 9 here, as we'll spend this morning, that confirms all the promises made here and back in chapter 6, verse 18. So I want to just lay a little bit of foundation before we read the text, because I want it to, I think it'll pop out to you as we walk through. You're going to hear this word, my covenant, I will, my covenant, over and over here in the text. What is a covenant? What is a covenant? Growing up in church, I don't remember, and you probably, I don't remember a lot of things over the last year. I'm forgetting a whole lot as I get older. But we need reminding of what these terms mean. So what is a covenant? Tom Schreiner has a very simple definition that encapsulates a lot. But as he says, a covenant is a chosen relationship in which two parties, two groups, two people, make binding promises to each other. And that's what happens here. Except here in this covenant, the Noahic covenant, as it is known as, was and is, because it's still going. The scriptures don't speak of this covenant ever ending. This covenant goes on, especially in our time, until the end of time, until the Lord returns. Number one, this covenant was universal. It means that all living people and creatures are involved. It was unilateral. That's meaning that God alone is the initiator. Man really does nothing within this covenant. His responsibility to this is God establishing, reestablishing, as we'll learn here and see, that he's the initiator. We've seen that already in Scripture. God is the initiator, right? He makes man. We're not a big deal. He is. He's awesome. We're not. But he makes us awesome by placing his Spirit in us once he causes us to be born again. So we see that the Noahic covenant is universal, is unilateral, and it's unconditional. No matter what man does now, God will not destroy the earth again with water. The church should say amen. I know there's been times where he thought he's going to flood the earth. Like it come rain. It was a flood and then lightning driving in this morning. I was like, only thing was missing is I just didn't get to see the rainbow yet. We're going to touch on that this morning. A story that we are pretty familiar with, but there's a lot here. And I want to try to squeeze it in a timely fashion this morning. And hopefully show us truths and God would speak to us from his word this morning. The first occurrence of this term covenant showed up here in chapter 6, verse 18. You remember, if you flip over, I'll just share that with you. In the midst of the Lord telling Noah he's going to destroy the earth, he says in verse 18, "But I will establish my covenant with you, and you shall come into the ark, your sons, your wives, and your sons with you, and every living thing of all flesh you shall bring two of sword in the ark to keep them alive with you. They shall be male and female." And then he walks through that. So this word appears first here in this narrative, here in Genesis. And to understand this word in particular, we don't see it in the English as much, but it's very important that we understand this. What God is doing in establishing this covenant with Noah is he's not starting a new covenant. And the Hebrew words here are significant. It doesn't mean to cut. To establish doesn't mean to cut. It means to reestablish, to reaffirm commitments that were already made. And we see this in the construction of this word. And I understand you, like me, I'm not great in Hebrew. So I have to go to other sources. One, any linear commentaries, and trust men who have studied the Hebrew well. And having some training in that has helped me a ton. I'm indebted to my brother Peter Gentry and Stephen Wellum in a book and a class I took on biblical theology that helped me understand more of what God is teaching us here, that then opens up more and more of the scriptures to see just exactly what God is communicating to us. And so I'm not going to get too nerdy, but I want you to understand that nowhere do we read here until we get to this covenant with Abraham, which I think we've all heard that, right? Father Abraham, the many sons. We sing songs about it in Sunday school, right? That is when God will cut a covenant. That's when he establishes a new covenant with Abraham. But here, he's reestablishing. So a good question comes to mind. What is he reestablishing? What is he starting over again? And you're going to hear this as we read the text here in a moment. I want you to look up on the screen or look in your copy of God's Word. If you don't have a copy of God's Word, there should be one there in front of you. You can turn right there at the beginning, Genesis 9. But he's reestablishing the covenant he had with creation, with Adam, that was then lost, right? It's lost in that the rebellion happened, and then God flooded the earth, and he's starting over with Noah as a new Adam. That's what he's doing. Now, we all know the story. Does it go well? Is Noah the Redeemer? Is he the one who's going to give man his rest? That's what his name means? No. No, he's going to royally mess up, right? As we read on into 9 and go through his descendants. But God is faithful to keep his promises. So what he is doing here is he is making good on his commitment. God is reestablishing the covenant that he made with Adam, and he's starting over with Noah. So as we read this, I want you to listen. Listen to the creation language, and it'll be easy to pick up even in the English. That's why the copy of God's Word, I hope just talking a little bit about Hebrew there, it didn't get you all discombobulated. Listen, you don't have to know Hebrew and Greek to know God's Word. Is it helpful? Absolutely. That's the original language, right? But our English Bibles are so very accurate. I mean, very accurate. Accurate enough to give you all that you need to pursue holiness and godliness. All that you need to know God and to walk in obedience with Him. To know Him as the Lord. And so, I invite you to stand with me as we read. I'm going to pick up in verse 20 of chapter 8, and we'll read to 17. And just listen. Listen to the creation language. First off here in 8, you're going to listen to the worship and the response of God. This is the word of the Lord in our language. How blessed we are to have it. Genesis chapter 8, verse 20. Then Noah built an altar to the Lord and took some of every clean animal and some of every clean bird and offered burnt offerings on the altar. And when the Lord smelled the pleasing aroma, the Lord said in his heart, I will never again curse the ground because of man. For the intention of man's heart is evil from his youth. Neither will I again strike down every living creature as I have done. While the earth remains, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night shall not cease. And God blessed Noah and his sons and said to them, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. The fear of you, the dread of you shall be upon every beast of the earth and upon every bird of the heavens and upon everything that creeps on the ground and all the fish of the sea. Into your hand they are delivered. Here it is. Every moving thing that lives shall be food for you. And as I gave you the green plants, I give you everything. But you shall not eat the flesh with its life. That is, its blood. And for the lifeblood, I will require a reckoning. From every beast I will require it, and from man. And from his fellow man I will require a reckoning for the life of man. Verse 6. Whoever sheds the blood of a man, by man shall his blood be shed. For God made man in his own image. And you, be fruitful and multiply, and increase greatly on the earth, and multiply in it. Then God said to Noah and to his sons with him, behold, I establish my covenant with you and your offspring after you and with every living creature that is with you, the birds, the livestock, and every beast of the earth with you, as many as come out of the ark, as it is for every beast of the earth. I establish my covenant with you that never again shall all flesh be cut off by waters of the flood, and never again shall there be a flood to destroy the earth. And God said, this is the sign of the covenant that I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you for all future generations. I have set my bow in the cloud, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. When I bring the clouds over the earth and the bow is seen in the clouds, here it is, I will remember my covenant that is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh. And the water shall never again become a flood to destroy all the earth. Amen. When the bow is in the clouds, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all flesh that is on the earth. God said to Noah, this is the sign of the covenant that I have established between me and all flesh that is on the earth. May the Lord bless his word to our heart. Pray with me if you will. Father, we thank you and we praise you for your word. Your word is truth and it is good. And Lord, you have told us exactly who you are. We see here in Genesis, Lord, that you're revealing yourself as the good creator. And that, Lord, man, is we are sinful. And Lord, we need you. We thank you that you're the God of covenant. That you are loving and faithful for all generations. Thank you for your faithfulness to us. And we pray this morning, Lord, as we seek to understand more of your word, that your spirit would teach us. Help me, Lord, to communicate your word clearly. Help us to receive it as it is truth, as it is your very word. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated together. Amen. Scripture claims to be God's written word. And as such, it is a unified revelation of God's gracious plan of redemption. The unifying theme of the scriptures is Christ. God created the world through Christ, for Christ, and by Christ, Colossians tells us. And all of Scripture, we trace this out. In regard to what Scripture actually is, what we're seeing as we walk through it and as we read it, it is God is progressively revealing himself to us. Most specifically in our time, he reveals himself through his Son, through Jesus, right? He is the manifestation of God the Father to us. We get to see what God is like in flesh and bone. And so God is revealing. God's plan is rooted in history and is developed along a specific storyline. And it's demarcated by the biblical covenants. Now, what does that mean? What does it mean to demark? When I worked for the phone company, any phone men or anybody, if you hear the word demark, we'd have a demark location point. We would take dial tone to the phone into from the dial tone from the telephone pole into a house or into a building outside at your house, which this is kind of a thing of the past now, right? We all got cell phones. But you used to have the old rotary phones, and even before that you had to get on and call up, you know, Ellie on the, hey Ellie, patch me through, or you know, I wasn't picking on my daughter Ellie, but there was an Elliot Bell South down in Savannah. Sarah, put me through, or we watch Andy Griffith, you know, they get on there and they call in, and they would listen in, and Andy would listen in to Barney. That's nothing to do with it. But anyway, I love Andy Griffith's show, but that's not going to help you with the covenant. But anyways, you take the dial tone, comes from the telephone pole to the outside of your house, and then from there you run your inside service wire. That would go to your hardline phone, go to your that old 75-pound black phone that if you ever got mad and you could use that thing as a weapon to guard your home, right? It weighs so much. And those things still work. We'd have to remove those out of houses as things begin to progress with technology. But, boy, those old black rotary phones, man, those things were awesome. But anyway, some of you kids, you got no clue what we're talking about. Rotary? What in the world is that, right? Anywho, how about going here? But maybe a little. But anyways, you'd have a demark location point. The dial tone would go to there, and then it would go to another point. If you go to a business, it would go inside like the basement, and from there, all the your phone system would go off of that demarcation point. The covenant serves that. The covenant with creation, the covenant with Noah, the Abrahamic covenant, the Mosaic covenant, the covenant with David. All of these covenants serve as it would the backbone of the story of Scripture, of God revealing himself. And he does this through the covenants because he's a covenant God. Yeah. He's a covenant-making, covenant-keeping God. And God by nature is loving and faithful. Yeah. He abounds in steadfast love and faithfulness. He will see as we walk through, we get through Genesis, Lord willing, we'll walk right into Exodus, and we'll see that he reveals himself to Moses, right? In the cloud, he descends. The Lord, a God gracious and merciful, abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. And he shares about his justice, that he will see that justice is served. He forgives sin and iniquity, but he will judge those who rebel against him. Right? So the covenants serve as that. They serve as really the backbone of the Bible, of the Bible story about Christ. Listen to this from my brother Peter and friend. And he sums this up. And I'm only taking a portion because there's just a little bit more. But the biblical story begins with the fact that there's only one God. This is where we've come already. He has created everything, and especially he has made humankind to rule under him. In this context, God is the center of the universe. And we humans find our purpose in having the right relationship to God and to one another. The first man and woman, however, rejected this way. Now, what happens when God is no longer the center of our universe? Who steps in to take his place? Why, we do. I want to be at the center of the universe. Will this work? No, because you want to be there too. So chaos and evil have reigned since the rebellion of Adam and Eve, because we no longer had a right relationship with God and did not treat each other as genuinely human. God judged the entire human race and made a new start with Noah. This too, as we'll see, ended up in chaos and evil, as is clear from the story of the Tower of Babel, where God then will confuse the languages. That's how we have so many different languages. This is why there would be a need to speak in tongues. It's because of sin, right? In the beginning, God scatters them. And then God speaks through the different languages so that they hear the gospel when you fast forward so many centuries to the book of Acts and the coming of the Holy Spirit. So what is God teaching us this morning? What do we see here? Turning back to chapter 8, verses 20, we'll pick up. We see here in this covenant with Noah that he's reestablishing what he has already established with Adam, who failed. And he's going to start over with Noah, and let me tell you what, Noah's going to fail. Because here's the thing, man, humanity fails. We sin. We are failures in and of ourselves. We can't make ourselves right with God. We can't make ourselves acceptable in his sight. He is holy and perfect, so we need him to intervene. We need him to take initiative. Have you not seen that already? God has taken the initiative. He loved Adam and Eve so much that he kicked them out of the garden that he may bring them back into the garden, you see. All of this a part of his big plan of demonstrating his glory of redemption, that he is a God who is loving and faithful. And he wants to show that to his image bearers who are indeed rebellious. But now we're not, even though we battle that as Christians. And if you're here and you've never trusted in Christ, you are a rebel at heart, and you need to repent and trust Christ. So what we see here in verse 20 is we see, chapter 8, we see that Noah is worshiping God. Our main point this morning, or in this verse, is God is worthy of our worship. Amen? God is worthy of your worship. Another way to say this, God is worthy of your life. All of it. All of it. You're going to spend it with him or without him very soon. And I trust that you're going to spend it with him. That's what he desires. That's why he's revealed himself to us clearly in his word. Noah is worshiping God. Noah built an altar to the Lord, took some of the every clean animal and some of every clean bird, and offered burnt offerings on the altar. If you go back, remember, he told him to make provision for this. What he's doing is making sacrifice. This burnt offering that leads us, as we'll see as we get on. I can't spend a lot of time here. But the Lord smelled the pleasing aroma of these animals that were being burnt and cooked and smoked. The Lord said in his heart, I will never again curse the ground because of man. Noah makes sacrifice to the Lord. He gives his best to the Lord. Why? That's a great question. What has God done? He has delivered him from a catastrophic flood. Think about what he has heard and witnessed with the ear. God was gracious in keeping him probably from seeing it with his eyes, right? He closed him in. He closed him in to shelter him. But no doubt he had to hear the screams. As humanity and creation are destroyed, he comes off this box that's been floating like a bobber for over a year, right? Or 150 days. And he comes out of there. What does he do? He worships. He worships the Lord. Listen, this morning, if you have trusted Christ as your Savior, He has delivered you from the greatest catastrophe ever, which is sin and His wrath that abides upon you. That has been so totally removed from you that you now are brought back into the presence of God the Father through the blood of the new covenant. That covenant we celebrate tonight as we take communion together and celebrate looking back what Christ did. He delivered us from God's wrath. So what is our response this morning, church? What is our response today, tonight, tomorrow, Tuesday, Wednesday, when you're tired of work and I just want to go home, right? We worship Him. We worship Him with our lives. And that comes out in so many different ways. It comes out with submitting our marriages, submitting our families, submitting our resources, submitting our church to the Lordship of Jesus. That's what we're a part of. That's what we're doing each and every day. And so it's a daily worship and surrender to the Lordship of Christ. And I was meditating on this. It's a daily submission to the Holy Spirit and obedience to the Word of God. We must know His Word for Him to continue to change us and make us who He wants us to be. And so the only proper response to God's faithful, loyal love is worshiping and giving God our very best. That's what Noah does. He comes. Now look in verse 21. He says, "Never again will I curse the ground because of man. For the intention of man's heart is evil from its youth." So guess what is carried on through the ark? Every intention is sinful. God knows, doesn't He? He knew in Genesis 3:15 what He was doing. And He knew exactly what He was doing in Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. When He created the world, He had a purpose in mind. His glory and the redemption of image bearers to know Him in a special, intimate way as the God of covenant, the God of grace, the God of forever faithfulness. And so God will respond to worship that is pleasing to Him. That second point, look at 21 and 22. "Neither will I again strike down every living creature as I've done. While the earth remains, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night shall never cease." I can't stay here too long. I was sharing this morning. I always take too long on first introduction and main point, but our first point. But here's the thing. You know what we can count on until the Lord returns? The sun come up. Matter of fact, He gives it here to us. "The earth remains, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer, winter, day and night shall not cease." You count on it. It's going to happen. God's promises hold true. Noah's worship and offering pleased the Lord. And this burnt offering is pointing us to, I put this in the notes so I didn't overlook it because it's really easy to overlook it. This is pointing us to the sacrificial atonement needed to satisfy God. This is what Jesus, He would become the offering. He didn't literally become sin. He was the sin offering. He Himself was perfect and sinless and offered. These animals were a representative of that. And so the sacrifice was a pleasing aroma to the Lord. It satisfied Him. And although God knew that sin still stamped and defined humanity, God commits really to Himself. And He shares that commitment. He shares that covenant with Noah and his family, and with us, for it's an everlasting covenant, right? It goes on for generations. And we're going to see that He gives a sign for it. Not every covenant has a sign, but this one does. And this sign is that glorious rainbow that we see, right? Aren't those things beautiful? A rainbow. We're going to talk about that here in a little bit. So listen, verses 1 to 17. God always provides clear instructions in His Word. He always provides clear instructions. He does not leave us in the dark. We will not come to the end of time and stand before the judgment seat of Christ when He passes out rewards. I'm talking to Christians here. And say, "Hey man, I just didn't know. I didn't know you well enough." Especially here in America. We have God's Word. We can't plead ignorance. We can't say we don't know. We got His Word. We got to read His Word. The problem is we don't know His Word as we are, myself included. Because we have to be intentional to spend time in His Word. And so we're ever growing in that, right? And learning more and more about the Lord. God always provides clear instruction. He has done that right from the beginning. He did that with Adam. He's done that with Noah. He's been very clear. He uses this verse 1 and verse 7 of chapter 9. He bookends in reminding us. You see, we're writing, we're very repetitive, but he's bookending, two bookends on your bookshelf, holding your books up together. What does he bookend? Look at verse 1. And God blessed Noah and his sons and said to them, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth. What does that sound like? What he told Adam. Look at verse 7. And you, be fruitful, multiply, increase greatly on the earth and multiply in it. What he is saying, and God blessed Noah, he's bookending it with blessing. The blessing of the fruit of the womb. The blessing of having babies, image bearers. Children, contrary to our culture, are a blessing. Humanity is a blessing. Every person has intrinsic value because we're made in the divine image, you see. Everyone matters, whether that child is born with a deformity or they have some type of a physical defect. God is intentional. He knows what he's doing. And because of the fall, you have all of that, but that person still has value. They're still made in the image of God. And our world devalues that. Our governmental system now devalues that. It once did not. It does now. We are killing babies at an astonishing rate. And people are in favor of it, even inside the church. God help us. Why does it matter? Because it matters to God, right? And so we stand up. Life is important. God has told Noah and his family, he promises that he will preserve life for Noah, his seed, and every living thing. So here, and I was sharing about the covenant. The covenant, if you remember, is a commitment, or an agreement between two parties to have binding promises, right? Well, here are the two parties is revealed to us. Who is it? It's with God and all of creation, all living creatures, all living beings, animals, the earth, his image bearers. This is what he makes. We see this in verses 8 through 11. What you see here is the land. He's making covenant. You see the land, you see the sea, and you see covenant. These three, they walk through the scriptures together. You'll see, we'll develop this more and more. I will when I preach and share this with you. The promise of covenant is reiterated here in this text. This is a covenant which God binds himself, God obligates himself, and he will maintain the covenant in spite of human failure. We should say amen, because we fail. We fail. Every intention of the heart during Noah's time was evil, right? But now, because of the work of the gospel, not every heart is evil anymore. For he has his redeemed image bearers, who he has redeemed, he has justified, and that he is sanctifying. He is redeeming. He is changing. And one day he will glorify when redemption is fully accomplished and applied, I should say, in our resurrection of the bodies, right? It has been accomplished at the resurrection, which we celebrated a couple Sundays ago on Easter. And we celebrate this morning that Jesus got up out of that grave and he's ascended after 40 days and seated at the right hand of the Father. And he intercedes for us now that we get to know him. We get to obey the instructions he's given us in his word and follow him. So the covenant is reiterated over and over. But the covenant finds itself, its fulfillment in God himself, right? Think about how this points us to the new covenant. Just real quickly. I'm not going to go any deep in there. I don't have that here. It points, God keeps both sides of that covenant. That covenant is in Jesus' blood. We'll talk about that tonight, so I encourage you to come back and celebrate communion with us. The covenant's in Christ's blood. He's done it all. So now my salvation is not based on how I perform or what I do. When I sin, guess what? I have a high priest who has passed through the heavens, who has come to earth, took on flesh, lived the perfect life I couldn't live, died the death I deserved, and rose again the third day, so that now all I have to do is come to the Lord and repent and have forgiveness, confess, and he will forgive us and restore, not relationship, fellowship. See, once you're born again and you're saved, that relationship is established. Why? Because God has purchased that, you see. But when we fail and we mess up and we sin, and we do because we have that old nature in us, we then can confess because we have a great high priest who will forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness, 1 John 1:9 tells us. And so we should keep short accounts with the Lord. Keep short accounts with the Lord, brother, sister in Christ. Yes, you've repented and you've been saved, but then your life should be marked by joyful repentance. You do realize that when the God's Holy Spirit and His Word convicts you of sin, that's a good thing. That's a good thing. With repentance and confession comes freedom. That I'm right with my Maker, and God wants to make me right in my relationships here now. So there's always forgiveness. So that's why there should be joyful repentance. Are there tears with that repentance many times? Absolutely there is. God, what it is, it breaks our heart that we do things that break His. Things that His Son died for. The things that His Son lived for. We should want to live for those things, you see. So we come to the Lord in joyful repentance day after day, knowing that God is making us who He wants us to be. All as we submit ourselves to His instructions. So God is gracious in that He provides an everlasting sign. Look at verses 12 to 17. 12 to 17 in chapter 9. God said, this is the sign of the covenant that I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you. For all future generations, I've set my bow in the cloud, and it shall be a sign of covenant between me and the earth. When I bring the clouds over the earth, the bow is seen in the clouds. I will remember my covenant that is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh. And the water shall never again become a flood to destroy all flesh. When the bow is in the clouds, I will see it. You remember a few weeks ago we talked about the remembering of God? Like you're not like us, like He forgot something, right? We forget something, right? God is committing Himself to what He has already done. When He remembers, He knows His covenant. He knows what He has promised. And He keeps all His promises. When I see the sign, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all flesh that is on the earth. God said to Noah, this is the sign of the covenant that I've established between me and all flesh and all that is on the earth. He puts the rainbow in the clouds. And scripture is used a couple other times, one in Ezekiel, one in Revelation, where you have a complete rainbow. And it's interesting. Sometimes we see the rainbow in scripture, and even now, before the storm. Sometimes you see it during the storm. Sometimes you see it after the storm. God is faithful in every stage of our lives. He is faithful to keep His promise, not to destroy us, but to bring us to Himself through the Lord Jesus Christ. Who Himself is the ark of salvation. Who Himself is the one who upheld that boat, right? God gave us the rainbow. And think about, this is what's so wicked in our world with homosexuality and hijacking the rainbow. And I'm not sure they even, and I know they don't. They don't understand. They don't understand what they're even using there. For the bow that is placed in the clouds. I want you to think about that. The bow in the ancient Near East was a piece of weaponry that had an arrow on it. And they would use bow and arrow. That's right? They didn't have guns back then. Or God may have said, I put my gun in the clouds. You know? No, He put this weapon. The bow is multicolored. It's not now an instrument of harm to earth anymore. Now the bow is set in the clouds, and guess where the arrow is pointing? It's pointing upward. It is pointing to God Himself. And it's signifying for us that His wrath will not come upon humanity in a flood. It's coming upon, really, His Son, who is going to be revealed later in a few covenants, and specifically in the new covenant, in which Jesus will bear the full wrath of God Almighty on your behalf.
Yes, thank you, Lord.
Wrath has been removed. It's been pointed to heaven. And every time we see that cloud, that rainbow in the clouds, in the sky, guess who else is looking at it? God is. God is seeing it. He sees the rainbow, and he sees you through that rainbow. And he remembers his covenant. He knows his covenant. Warren Gage says this, the bow is a weapon of war, an emblem of wrath. God will now set it in the heavens as a token of grace. The Lord who makes his bow of wrath into a seven-colored arch of beauty to ornament the heavens is the one who will finally command the nations to beat their swords into plowshares and spears into pruning hooks, Micah 4:3. For the Prince of Peace takes pleasure in mercy, and the righteous judge delights in grace. What a sign of grace is the rainbow. A sign of deliverance. A sign of true freedom, right? Freedom from having to worry. Is it going to flood today? Is God going to destroy the earth today? No. He made a covenant. How many of you, when you ride with your kids and you see it, remind them of that covenant. And remind them of this. As you're looking at it, children, God is looking at you through it. Think of it today. Today, holy God in heaven, how does he not just wipe us out as sinners? Well, we've been transferred. We've moved from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of light. And we are covered by the blood of his Son, in which Jesus sees all of his people as righteous and holy. Through the one man, through the blood of Jesus, are we seen and we are made holy. For there is redemption in the blood of Christ. So, as I close, what does the covenant of Noah teach us? Just a few things. It teaches us a lot. Amen? There's a lot here. But just a couple things. God demands an accounting. I haven't touched on, and I need to go back just briefly in this, and I did this intentionally. Noah, as a new Adam, things have changed. It was plants, now we're given meat. We get to eat meat. And in one sense, amen. Right? I love meat. Some people are vegetarians. That's your view. I like meat. It's good. God made it for us to eat. I give you everything. But he gives specifics. But you shall not eat flesh when it's life, for that is the blood. So we're not to be like animals. An animal will devour another animal and eat it when it's blood pumping. It's alive, right? And we kill it, we drain the blood, then we grill it or smoke it or whatever. And we eat it or fry it. We're good about that in the South. But it's good, right? But things have changed. The animal kingdom will fear man, right? Back in verse 2. So things change, and it says, for your lifeblood, I will require a reckoning. From every beast I will require, and from every man. Every beast that kills a person, that beast is to be put to death. And every person, and here is where we get capital punishment. Is capital punishment biblical? Yes. Right here in the scriptures. And it's to be upheld by the government. So that man, who is very vindictive, someone killed my family, I would be very hard pressed. If anyone harms my family, I am going to try to protect my family the best I can. I'll stop there. But my vengeance and my anger would get pumping really fast. We know this. Someone says something against your child, whatever it is, your blood gets going, right? Whether it's true or not, anytime. So it's to be taken to courts. And so there's should be. And that is misused as well. And has been through history. And it always will be because we're fallen. But justice, God is after justice. Whoever sheds the blood of man, by man shall his blood be shed. For God made man in his own image. Why is life important? Because God made life in his image. And life is in the blood. The Lord is pointing us to so many things here. Number one, what does it teach us? God demands an accounting. Human responsibility is clear. All life is precious to God, especially those created in his image. See, we're different than the animal kingdom, for we're made in God's likeness to reflect him. Are we more important than animals? Yes. Let me make sure I'm clear on that. Because God is clear on that. Does that mean we don't love animals? Absolutely not. We're to care for them. Take care of them. They can provide friendship to us at a certain level, but not like another image bearer. Can't talk to us. Although those rascals know. I'll stay. Animals know, man. They're smart. They're not as smart as you. You're created in God's image. Number two, God's commitment is throughout all generations because God's covenant is everlasting. God is faithful. Amen, church?
Amen.
He's faithful to you. The rainbow remains as a witness to God and to us. And I put it there so you would remember that when you look up and see the rainbow, God is looking down at it. He's looking down at it, and you through his everlasting covenant sign. And Noah's covenant points us, and we'll walk through these other covenants that form the backbone and help us understand the storyline of Scripture, that the new covenant, he speaks of this in Ezekiel and Jeremiah, speak of a new covenant to come that has indeed come. And it's come in the person of Christ. God now sees us as his people through the blood of his son that was shed. His sinless blood. Not any kind of sacrifice. An unblemished, unstained, sinless sacrifice was that of Christ for you and for me. Amen? There's much more that can be said, but I pray that God will make application to our hearts from his word this morning. And we would know if we see that sign of the rainbow in the sky that God is loving and faithful. And he's going to deliver us. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. Father, we love you. We thank you for your love for us. Have your way in the hearts of your people, Lord. If anyone needs to do business with you, they know they can do that right where they're at. They can come to this altar. It's open for them to pray, to confess to you. And that you, Lord, will hear. We know that you hear and we know that you see. So God, thank you that you're the God who knows and the God who sees. You're the God who rescues and saves. You're the God who restores and redeems. Have your way by your Spirit for your glory and the good of your people, we pray. In Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. Amen. I'd like you to stand as we close in a song together. Thank you.
Man, church, you can be seated. Just take us through a few announcements real quick. We've had a good service. We've had great service. Thankful to worship and song. And heard a good word from the Lord, haven't we, church, this morning? Man, thank you, Brother Zad, Pastor Zad, for bringing that this morning. Just a few announcements here. As Zad already said, we'll be having communion tonight as recognition of that ordinance. Church, we want everybody to come back for this. Be a part of it with us. It's an ordinance, and then two, it's a special time to be together as believers to take part in that. So we just want to encourage you there to come back out. That's at 6 tonight, so be in prayer for that service. Also, on the 8th, we'll have our Mother's Day recognition. There will be no evening service. I want y'all to spend that with your loved ones and your family there and celebrate that day together. So no evening service on the 8th there. And then on the 15th, we'll have that graduate recognition service. And Jody's right back there. Jody, throw a hand up there. She needs photos, folks, of those who are graduating. And we use that term, like graduation, but understand, like, if you're finishing up at an apprenticeship, or if you've been to technical school, or just anything there that we can celebrate you in, church, we want to do that. So we say graduation, but know that, you know, if you're a part of that and you're moving on to that next stage, we want to celebrate you in that too. So she needs those photos there, and then also we'll be having lunch that day for them and their families right after service that day as well, morning service there. Trey planted this seed before service. I don't mean to get everybody in a row here, but he wants to talk about garden stuff right after we finish up. So y'all can, I wish still over there. Where you at? All right. So after service, he wants to have some garden talk. So y'all just come up front. Anybody who's interested in helping Matt do that there. So also, senior adult spring lunch, May 11th, fellowship hall, that's 11:30. And we've got sign-up sheets at the doors there. They want to know who's coming, so we know how much food to prepare. Also, there's a trip. I know Zad has mentioned this before. There's a group, I think specifically Broadway, is going, and they've invited them, open up to a couple other folks there. So there's a meeting Tuesday at 6:30 up there at Broadway. If you want to go to that or are interested, come see Pastor Zad, and he can tell you more about that. And then also, we all know what's coming, Vacation Bible School, right? So I, as far as I know from talking to Laura, there's been a lot of good response to that. We still want people to sign up, and we need a third and fourth grade boys teacher. So hope you're praying about that, church. If somebody will do that, we need somebody. You can go talk to Miss Laura Jones about that and get you signed up there. And then also want to let everybody know, I know we've got some new members. We've got an online directory here, and if you go to BethlehemBaptistChurch.net, you can sign up for that, and there's a form on there. That helps us keep in touch. That helps other people who are looking for your information, or if you're looking for somebody else's info, we want you to get signed up on that. So again, that's online there, and you'll be able to do that. Have I missed anything, church? Anybody have anything they need to share? If not, church, one more time, stand with me, and we're going to close in a word of prayer and just thank God for this morning. Let's pray. Church, Father, we come to you this morning, Lord, thanking you for all the learning, all the teaching that has taken place this morning. God, we thank you for the worship service that we've had. Father, we thank you for being supreme, Lord, and we recognize that, and we recognize who you are, Father, and celebrate that, God, and we want to give you that worship and have gathered corporately this morning to do that, Father. Lord, we thank you for Jesus Christ, God, and the redemption. Father, we thank you for the resurrection, for his death on the cross, and for him coming and atoning us back to you, God. Lord, we thank you for the word that we heard this morning. God, help us to apply it to our lives. Father, one that we know that you are worthy. You're the only one worthy of our worship. Father, and we want to apply that to our life. We also, God, thank you for Zad as he's exposited the word this morning and shown us so much this morning. We thank you for all the learnings there, God. Thank you for the music and the singing, God, and all the business that's being done here to be a part of your kingdom, God, and the privilege to be able to do that. God, we thank you for that. Lord, be with us as we go out. Father, we're encouraged to see the group here. Lord, we're encouraged to see visitors. God, we ask you to bless them. Lord, bring them back. God, we thank you just really for everything that has happened this morning, to have a breath in our lungs, God, that we could use to give back to you in worship. God, we pray for this church. We pray for the congregation, those who couldn't be here. God, and everywhere that your word has gone out this morning, we just pray that it's applied. Lord, and we know that it will be, Lord. Father, again, thank you. Be with us as we go today to enjoy fellowship and come back tonight to take part in communion together, Lord. Father, again, we thank you for all these things. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.